All right, it's going.
So now I'm just gonna really talk about how women's groups, and I ran a retreat at the time, during Reza Shah's reign, who was before Muhammad, his son. He basically repressed women's groups with his police force, because he kind of saw them as a threat, and this was one of the reasons that he was very disliked, because he was very repressive to many groups to keep his power. However, by the end of his regime, so after World War II, and by when his son was starting to gain power, women began joining more political parties and became much more active in the political scene. And his son, Muhammad Reza Shah, he was much more accepting to women's groups, and he even like united them all and formed the High Council of Iranian Women's Association. But you could arguably see this as a way where he could centralize all women's groups so that there weren't any dissenting opinions like of him or his regime. So women in the women's education and job force during this time, women's job began opening a lot more. And I think before Muhammad Shah's reign, they would have like a 6% participation of workforce, but they boosted up to around, I think, 12%, which might not seem like a lot, but it set my law for Iran at the time. There was also an increase in literacy rate for women. However, this kind of lacked in certain areas, especially in more rural areas. And however, formal education, so like education from universities, was not very prominent among many. And because of accelerated economic development, especially with communication with Western nations, women became much more active in the job market. However, most of these jobs were fairly artificial and were mainly like domestic jobs in houses, for example, or in restaurants. So I'm just gonna briefly talk about women after the revolution. Not gonna have a lot because I think Persepolis does a pretty good job at talking about how Iran, and especially for women in Iran, was at the time, and especially during the Iran-Iraq War. So basically the FPA, which if you don't remember was the Family Protection Act, was completely dismantled. This might seem like a very big thing, but it was actually fairly small, mainly because, like I said, the Family Protection Act didn't really do that much for Iranians, especially women. It was just kind of seen as like a way that the Shah could get more favorability among many. Women, however, still had access to universities and education, which you can see when Margie attends university. And the only major change, I think, was first it was decreased interaction with the West, and this was probably the biggest thing that happened was the Islamic fundamentalist leaders did not want to have any more contact with the West and saw them as polluting Iranians. And also the veil was now mandatory, as you can see just at the beginning of Persepolis, when Marjorie said it was 1980 and the veil was now a necessity for women. And just to basically finish this off, I found a pretty good video. I think it's a pretty good representation of how conditions change for women, or at least how it's just a fairly good video to show, like, at least especially for our time period, on like the differences in women between 1970 and 1980. So yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about the region as a whole and then go in a little bit to the Iran-Iraq war. So this was the Middle Eastern region. The green outline here denotes the Ottoman Empire before World War I, and then you see how the French and the British came in and basically carved out that whole empire and artificially drew borders for Iraq and Syria and a host of other nations. And this is going to cause a lot of problems that you're going to see in the region, and that provide a lot of reasoning for why the region is how it is in the book when we first meet. So this is what the borders will become like after they carve up the Ottoman Empire in the region. The problem with this is a religious map, and you see Iran is about the only major Shiite nation in the entire region, and the other ones have scattered pockets of minorities, especially in Iraq, that plays a large role in the start of the Iran-Iraq war, because these groups hate each other, basically, and they come to marginalize each other anywhere there's a minority of one or the other. And this isn't even as bad as what this next map is going to show you, which this is the ethnic distribution. And you see, with the exception of some of these majority Arab nations here, the entire region is pockmarked full of different groups, a lot of which quite often disagree very violently. Now, once we get into the Cold War, this is how it is. This is the map, again, of what the border is. And you see the Soviet Union and the U.S. obviously competing for influence. And the U.S. sides with Israel, which basically allows Russia to gain influence, in, with the exception of Saudi Arabia, every major nation here, and except for Turkey, too. So when we see, that's why the Shah being installed was such a viable option for us, was because that we could not allow the Soviet Union to go in and awful dominate Iran. We were looking for another stable country to ally with besides Israel. So once the British originally decided to push for installing the Shah and overthrowing the Prime Minister, as the Iranian Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh nationalized Western, specifically British-built and operated oil wells and refineries in Iran. They did this because the British wouldn't allow him to audit their books and see if they were getting a fair price for the oil that was being exported from the country. Initially, Britain just settled for a boycott and blockaded any Iranian oil from leaving with the Royal Navy. However, they managed to convince the CIA that they should overthrow the Prime Minister and install General Fazili Zahedi, who then ushered in the Shah, due to the fact that the Prime Minister, in order to maintain the power in the face of increasing domestic unrest as a result of the blockade, turned to the Communist Party in Iran for support on the ground. And that quickly led us to fear that he would basically become another Soviet vassal state like all of Eastern Europe, which allowed the British intelligence agency, the MI6, to convince us to go in and overthrow the Prime Minister. And we basically did that by paying people to pose as communists, to incite the communists to attack everything they saw as signs of capitalism and the government. And then the CIA also paid street thugs to act as anti-communists and incite the general public to fight the communists. And this unrest allowed the military under the general to come in under the guise of installing order and then conquer all the government buildings and depose the Prime Minister and then install the regime of the Shah. Under the Shah, U.S.-Iran relations soared. They saw a mass influx of American companies, such as oil companies, which we did in order to break the British monopoly, which is part of why we went in. They were a major pillar of relations in the area. They got massive supplies, top-of-the-line arms, such as fighters, helicopters. This played a major role in how the Iran-Iraq war follows. However, following the 1979 revolution, U.S. Iranian revolution obviously basically failed to exist. Now, the Iran-Iraq war, which we see plays a prominent role in the book, basically starts under standard geopolitical territorial disputes, which also had underlying religious and ethnic causes, which I pointed out how there was that Sunni minority in the south of Iraq. Saddam Hussein would use that as an excuse saying that the Iranian Revolution was trying to incite them to revolt against them. But really what was over was this little strip of land here and these islands, which control, obviously Iraq has very limited access to the ocean, and they wanted to control as much of that as possible. And Iranian and Iraqi disputes over this territory were all that was needed to push it out and Hussein to invade, seeing Iran as weak due to the revolution. They thought they could easily push him quickly while they were in disarray and take what they wanted. So they launched a massive, unannounced preemptive strike, and they gained some early momentum, but it quickly degenerated into a World War I-style stalemate. It saw human wave attacks by the Iranians, chemical warfare usage by the Iraqis to stop human warfare, these human wave attacks. However, the Iranians managed to hold the ground, mainly because they managed to dominate Iraq early on in the year with their U.S. supplied F-14s. F-5s and F-4s, which managed to basically wipe out the Soviet-supplied air force of the Iraqis. But most of the world at this point was supporting Iraq. They saw the Iranian Revolution as a threat to the region, and as the war goes on, the Iraqi forces quickly degenerate, though, because they lack the spare parts to keep up their fight. So this is basically a map of how the war goes. Over time, Iran pushes in a little bit, but it doesn't really go anywhere, and it lasts, it's the longest conventional war of the century, lasting from 1980 to 1988, and it kills hundreds of thousands of soldiers and thousands of civilians, whether that be in Scud missile strikes, which destroy houses like they do in the book, or in chemical warfare usage, even against their own populations, as happens in Iraq. Also during this, I believe the video we watched mentioned it too, the Iran-Contra affair happened, where the video claimed that we supplied arms in order to balance out the regional power, but we really supplied arms to Iran because they held American hostages in one of their terrorist organizations in Lebanon, and we supplied them with a limited amount of anti-tank weapons in order to essentially goad the more moderate faction in the Iranian government into helping us get them released from that terrorist organization. This war finally ended in 1988 with a negotiated peace through the UN. And that's the Scud missile that took out the house of her neighbor in the book. They're ballistic missiles, and Saddam Hussein used them a lot, especially because the Air Force wasn't capable of getting past the Iranian Air Force, but they had no real way of stopping ballistic missile attacks, so we launched hundreds of them and killed thousands of civilians. And that's a brief history of the region, and then we have Jack talk about some religious stuff.